also want to just give a moment of silence, just a moment of silence for the report that Brother Roach gave in terms of the outrageousness that occurred last week during the siege on the Capitol, the gross double standards exhibited by law enforcement vis-a-vis white terrorism versus black protesters. So just a moment of silence, if we could, for that. And now, really, we're going to be introducing someone who's going to talk about another gross outrageousness that has been going on for the past 47 years right here in the United States. I am just so honored and I'm thrilled, Roach, to bring to the stage none other than the Reverend Lukata Njumbe. We're talking about a bad brother. I mean, I was watching some video post. He's a pastor, you know, and he's up there sitting in the middle of the street, sitting in the middle of a demonstration, holding a vigil, a prayer vigil with all of these police, you know, around. That's courage. We're talking about activist pastor, Reverend Lukata Njumbe.
Thank you for joining us, Pastor.
Thank you.
He is a member of the Sundiata Akoli Freedom Campaign. He is the pastor of the historic Witherspoon Church Presbyterian Church, Witherspoon Street Presbyterian Church of Princeton, New Jersey. We're talking about a brother who is an activist. He's an organizer. He's a scholar. He's a lifelong advocate for freedom, justice, self-determination, and human rights of all oppressed people. Welcome, Reverend Lukata.
Thank you, sister. Thank you. Thank you, Brother Brown, for having me with you here today. It's an honor and a privilege.
It's our honor, man, because anytime we get a warrior, somebody on the front line fighting in the trenches, man, we got to bring you in, man, because this is about making things better for our people and our kind. So thank you for what you've been doing. We need more brothers like that.
Thank you for giving me the opportunity to talk about a true warrior, who has been fighting in the trenches and who has been in the dungeon for almost 48 years now, for the last 47 years, Sundiata Akoli. Yeah. Who has been in prison since 1973. And we have to know his story. We have to know his struggle, because in knowing his story and his struggle, it says a lot about the larger system of mass incarceration, of so-called criminal justice in this country. It also speaks to the reality of what's happening on the inside, particularly with our aging prisoners. And we've seen a legacy of those who have been incarcerated and imprisoned as a result of their political activities. And then we also see the political consequences that continue to play themselves out, and how people are in prison for longer. And even though they receive certain kinds of sentences, because of the nature of their arrest and their convictions, The state seeks to, even though we don't have the death penalty in the state of New Jersey, but the state of New Jersey seemingly tried to find another way to take Sundiata Akoli's life away, even though he does not have a death sentence. But if you're in prison with COVID-19, if you're in prison for moving on five decades, we know what the strategy is. And so I'm here today to talk about Sundiata Akoli, to talk about his life, to talk about his legacy, his struggle, and what we're trying to do this week and this year.
So let's just backtrack just for a moment, my brother, and just talk a little bit about his life before he went in prison, his life when he was back there in Texas. Just give us some of those highlights.
Well, you know, Sundiata Akoli is atypical in so many ways. This is a brother who is a mathematician, is one who is working for NASA, is one who is brilliant and had the opportunity to do so much in so many different ways. Yes, he was born in Texas in 1937. He comes out of a strong family, but he was also called to a call to justice and became involved in the civil rights movement. He came involved in the Black Liberation Movement. He was a member of the Black Panther Party for Self-Defense. He was arrested and imprisoned as a part of the New York 21 on all kinds of trumped up charges, ultimately exonerated and found not guilty for those charges. A group of 21 members of the Black Panther Party, but because of his commitment and because of the work that he had done, he, like so many others, were forced to shift from their work, the political work that they were doing, and really to pull back, and could not be open and public in all of their work, and had to go what's called so-called underground. And I think sometimes we romanticize some what that looks like, but it essentially meant that people were unable to be able to do work publicly without being arrested, without being harassed, or without even being killed. And so they had to pull back and pull away from their political work. A lot of what people don't know about Sundiata, even though they know what we find in a lot of his things that we find online, but Sundiata was active in different parts of the country. I came and did a good deal of my organizing work in the state of Alabama. And many people don't know the great work that Sundiata did in the state of Alabama, and how he was organizing with people in Alabama, and how he was supporting and training people in Alabama. And there are people now who are in state government. There are people now who are leaders in the Black community in the state of Alabama that remember the great work that he did when he was known as Clark Squire, which was the name of the legacy of the slave master that he had. But Sundiata has been actively engaged in all different kinds of work. What most people know, if they know anything about him, is they know him as the driver of the vehicle on the New Jersey Turnpike, where Asada Shakur was arrested, also known as Joanne Chesimard, and all of the history of Asada Shakur. The whole Black Lives Matter movement has really looked to Asada as one of the matriarchs of the movement, declaring that Asada taught me, looking to her legacy. You can learn more about her in her autobiography. But today, Nkechi, I really want people to focus on a different dimension of Sundiata.
And what is that? Tell us about that.
Sundiata Okoli is an 84-year-old father and grandfather. He'll be 84 this week. He'll be 84 on January 14th.
Woo!
On Wednesday, he will. Thursday. Is that Thursday? Thursday, he will turn 84 years old. He has been in prison since 1973. He is a father, he is a grandfather, he is an artist, he is a poet, he is a mentor for so many people. Some people don't know this. The way that I got the name Lukata Mjumbe, Sundiata Okoli gave that name to me in the early 1990s.
Wow.
He is the person who gave me my name, because when I was a college student at Morehouse College in Atlanta, Georgia, and working for an organization called Amnesty International USA that works for the human rights, works against the death penalty and for political prisoners, I read about his story. I wrote him a letter, and we became friends. Writing letters. He became my mentor. He became a father figure to me. Phone calls. He gave me my name. But he's going to turn 84 this week. He was diagnosed COVID-19 positive last year. He has multiple health issues and challenges. He has had an exemplary, a perfect disciplinary record for the last 27 years. He is no threat at all for committing future crimes. There is absolutely no reason to keep him in prison on this day. He has already served his life sentence. We already have had courts that have ruled that he should be released, but we have parole boards and we have politics in the state of New Jersey. He's a New Jersey prisoner held on New Jersey crimes, held in a federal prison, and politics have kept this aging, octogenarian father, grandfather, person who is in the twilight of his life, continue to be locked in a cage. I want us to talk about that today.
What was his charge? What was he charged? What was he convicted of?
He was convicted of the shooting of the New Jersey State Trooper in the state of New Jersey on the turnpike associated with the arrest of Joanne Chesimard of Asada Shakur.
So yeah, I remember the case.
He was convicted of those charges that occurred in 1973, and he has served his time. if you look at murders and people who are convicted of similar crimes in New Jersey and in other parts of the country, I mean, 47 years is unheard of. Just remember, Nelson Mandela served how many years in prison?
27.
He served 27 years in prison. I mean, the reason why he is there is because of political consequences and because of a broken system that has to be challenged. New Jersey itself has the highest, you mentioned the COVID-19 in prisons. New Jersey actually has the highest death rate for prisoners in the United States and from COVID-19. When we look at our numbers and you have the official count and you have the real count, you know, we're counting as many as 80 people who have died from COVID-19. And these aren't just prisoners. These are also officers. We look at the prison where Sundiata is right now in Cumberland, Maryland, in the federal prison in Cumberland, Maryland. And he's been held in federal prison since the mid-1970s. When he was in New Jersey, he was held in a cage that was smaller than the size that's required for a German Shepherd dog. Mm-hmm. He developed tuberculosis. They have been trying to kill this man for a long time. And so we have been demanding compassionate release. Compassionate release for Sundiata. He needs to come home this year. He should have come home years ago, but we are saying bring Sundiata home. That's our hashtag. That's our call. That's our cry this year. And we are declaring that with your help and with those who are listening, that we will bring Sundiata home this year to his grandchildren, to his community, to his family. So he can live out whatever life he has left outside of a prison cell.
So you know, Reverend Lucada, you mentioned parole. Can you tell us about how many times he has applied and denied parole?
12 times.
I know I wrote a book, a memoir called Black Power, Black Lawyer. And in that book, I put in one of the letters in support of his parole that I wrote January 29, 2010. That was 2010. Yeah. And I know that there were denials before then, and there have been denials since then. Can you just kind of give us a flavor of that? You might not have to have the exact number, but just a flavor.
Yeah, I mean, it's, I have, since I came from Alabama to New Jersey, and since I've been in New Jersey, coming in 2010, I think there have been three since I've been here. So in the last 10, 11 years, he's gone before three times. I remember going all the way back to the early 90s. And what happens with these prisoners is they come up for parole here and then they get a 5-year hit, a 10-year hit, a 15-year hit. They're not allowed
to come up. A 20-year hit at one point.
20-year
hit. Yeah, shit, that ain't right.
And so the parole system itself and the parole board is where so many of these contradictions have come. The hearing that I sat in a courtroom in Trenton, New Jersey, the panel of judges actually ruled there was no reason. There was no reason for him to continue to be in prison, that he had served his time, that he had met all of the requirements, that he should, a 20 year hit means that he won't come back up again.
He can't come before the parole board until the next 20 years. That's what
right.
And he's already been in over 20 when they said that, huh?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah. And so now we're going on 48. I think in May it'll be 48 years. Yeah. 48 years that he has actually served. And so the state of New Jersey actually appealed the decision of the judges that said that he should be released. And so his lawyers, and the reason why I'm not even able to give all of the exact number of times is it's hard for me to even keep up as a non-lawyer, because over and over again, we're seemingly like we're constantly going through an appeal process. And we're constantly getting good news and then bad news and then more bad news. And then we have to come and try to fight for some good news. And so what they're trying to do is run the clock out on his life. That he is now turning 84 years old this week. This year we have to bring him home. This year, and we have appealed to the governor of New Jersey. We have written letters. We have taken meetings. We have done the diplomatic route. We have had conference calls. We have had Zoom calls. We have had prayer meetings. We have had prayer vigils. I preached about them. We've marched. We protested. We've demonstrated. It is time that all of this has to come together, and we need to see some victory.
Yes.
You know, Reverend Lucada, I sent a birthday card to Sundiata last year when he turned 83. Excuse me. I attempted to send a birthday card. I thought I was following the guidelines. I thought it was black and white, a card, no glitter, no anything like that. And it was still sent back to me because I think it was cream colored instead of actual white. I mean, what is going on with that? And how can people send him letters or birthday greetings or anything along those lines?
Well, we are encouraging everyone to send a letter. And I emphasize, I don't even say birthday cards, because sometimes they'll say that the stock is too heavy. They don't want any kind of cardboard coming in. And so I say to people, send Sundiata Kohli a black and white letter. Get regular later. Get some school paper for what you would have did an essay in middle school. You can get lined paper. You can get plain copy white paper. Write it in black or blue ink, and write him a letter to the federal prison in Cumberland, Maryland. And I can give the address if you want me to.
Yes.
Yeah. Give it out. Give it out. And your phone numbers.
Sure. If you want to write, we're asking everyone to send Sundiata Kohli a birthday letter for his 84th birthday. It's one thing for us to write letters to governors. It's another thing for us to write letters for members of the government. We have to encourage this brother to let him know that he is known, that he is loved, and that there are people here on the outside that are thinking about him, caring about him, advocating him. Sometimes, and Brother Brown, you know, for those who are in prison, a letter can be a lifeline. It can be that light that says, you know what, I'm not in here by myself. People haven't forgotten about me. And so we're asking everybody, his birthday is coming up this week on January the 14th. He will turn 84 years old. You don't have to do a great work of literature. Say happy birthday. Say we love you. Say we miss you. Do the hashtag bring Sundiata home. And it's Sundiata Kohli, Sundiata. That's his first name. Akoli, Acoli. And then you have to put his prison number. So after you write
first his slave name.
Well, that too. You can then put in parentheses his slave name, and you can put Clark Squire, or you can just put Squire, Squre, and then his prison number 39794-066. I'm gonna say that again. Number 39794-066. So after you put that on the envelope, and I'm having to go basic like this, I know a lot of people who are younger than me have never even written a letter. They say emails, they send text messages, but in terms of filling out a letter, they don't even teach that in school anymore, I don't think. How to address a letter, Sundiata Kohli, parentheses, Squire, and then his prison number, and then you can write FCI, that's a federal correctional institution, Cumberland, Cumberland, and then you write under that, Federal Correctional Institution, P.O. Box 1000, Cumberland, Maryland, 21501. So that's FCI Cumberland, Federal Correctional Institution, P.O. Box 1000, Cumberland, Maryland, 21501. And again, send that to Sundiata Kohli, Squire, number 39794-066. Again, as Sister Nkechi said, know the rules and regulations. Don't put anything in the letter. Don't put any money. Don't put your
stamps
picture in
and
there.
Nothing.
Don't put stamps. Don't put a lock of hair.
Perfume or lipstick.
Perfume. Nothing. Nothing that can give them any reason to think that when you're sending it to Sundiata Kohli, Sundiata, that's Sundiata, Akoli, Acoli, make sure that there's nothing that can be used. And it's important that you that you follow these rules, because if you don't, as crazy as they may be, they will turn around and block it and send it back to you.
They may just
tear it up and throw it away.
They'll send it back several months later.
Right. And you won't even know that he ever received it. Now, what? My mother, I was born in Washington, D.C. My mother, who lives in Prince George's County, Maryland, is now saying that when she writes Sundiata, he gets the letter in about 4 days. So you have time. Go ahead and send it today. Write your letter today, handwritten or typed. Put it in a plain white envelope. Don't put it in a red envelope. Don't put it in a red, black, and green envelope. Don't put it in a blue envelope. No colors on the envelope. A white envelope. Don't even send it in a brown manila envelope. So this is a legal envelope. Now, get you a white envelope on white piece of paper, because he's being held in a white supremacist institution. Maybe that's what you need to have to remind you.
Yes,
make sure
yes.
It's all on white, and write your words in black.
And please remember that all mail, unless it's legal mail, is going to be open. So don't put nothing stupid in there that you wouldn't want on the front of the Washington
Post. Understand that somebody else is reading your mail, everything that you write. Now, it's okay. You can put a return address. That's up to you if you want to. That's fine to do that. It's safe. There's no threat at all. You know, if you are worried about the government knowing about what you're doing and what you're saying and whatever else. The truth of the matter is, if you're really doing something, then they already know. They already know. It's all we have been out here long enough. I remember when I was in college and I was writing letters to Sundiata Okoli, and I was writing letters to Dr. Mutulu Shakur, and I was writing letters then to Sekou Odinga. You know, We knew back when I was 18, 19 years old, okay, we got a file. We know there's a file. But you get to control on some level what's in your file. So we have to stand up and we have to be open about our support for Sundiata Okoli, about the need to bring him home this year. And it starts with these birthday letters, but it will continue. Write the letter. I expect Sundiata will write you back. He is good for that. I've known him to do that for decades, and other people can testify to it. He helped me write my papers when I was in college. He helped me prepare my resume. He calmed me down when I was in my 20s and got me to travel a path that would not lead for me to end up in prison. Sundiata is teaching other classes. In prison, he's teaching people on what to do once they get out, how to make use of their time in prison. He is well respected. He is understood as someone who is not only an incredible asset to our community, but he's someone that absolutely has no reason to continue to be incarcerated. People in the prisons know that.
He done aged out. We got to take a break.
Okay.
And we'll be right back. The name of this show, or the title of our show, is "Why Are So Many Black Panthers Still in Prison?" And we're talking about Sundiata Okoli, one who's been in over 47 years. Folks, we have 16 to 20 more people, Black Panthers, who've been in, who are still incarcerated, been in 30, 40, for some 50 years. And for those of you who don't know what the Black Panthers are, what their history is, they came about during the same time in the 60s and the 70s, what we're going through right now in the 90s and 100s, with all the police shootings and cop killings and all this brutality and racism against us in the court system. The Black Panthers came out of that, and they empowered people and gave us a ray of sense of hope, and a lot of people joined. And now we got these men and women who risked their lives for us 40, 50 years ago, and they're still in prison. So we have to get together to do something.
Amen.
To bring them out of these institutions. So we'll take a break. If you want to call in with a question for Reverend Lucado Mujumbe to Lakeisha or me, the phone number to call is 202-588-0893. That's 202-588-0893. We got 16 to 19 more men and women still in prison, been in 30, 40, 50 years. Black Panthers who've been risking their lives for us, going through the same thing we're going through now, with the cops and the police brutality, is what they went through. And most of them are still in because they've been accused or suspected of killing a cop. I had a life sentence, and life was could constitute 20 years. Sundiata Okoli has been in two lives. He's been in over 40 years. That's two life sentences, people. You don't have a life when you come out. What can you do? bring our people home. We know about the racism, the discrimination, the segregation. We ain't got to keep going through all this jiggy boogie about a law for this and the appeal for that. And that United States Federal Parole Board, I know they gave out 10, 15, 20 year hits. They are not, when they send them from New Jersey to the federal system, he's on the Federal Parole Board of Authority, and they're supposed to use apply New Jersey law for New Jersey prisoners. They don't do that. They do what the hell they want to do. So we'll take a break and be right back. If for anybody with a question or comment, call in for our guest. We'll be right back after this break. What you say?
Spend it all, the have nots. Money, we make it. For we see it, you take it. Oh, make me wanna holler the way they do my life. Make me wanna holler the way they do my life. This ain't living, this ain't living.
Okay, Mike. Yeah, make you want to holler the way they do our life. And this ain't living, people. We in the street and we ain't living. We're locked up in the street. When they tell you to go in and self-quarantine, that's like being in a hole of solitary or administrative segregation. People, we are in the streets and death is around the corner. I get a call almost every other day of somebody who passed away. And baby, it's frightening and it's scary. Let's bring our fathers and grandfathers and grandmothers home from these institutions. Y'all know this stuff ain't right. Y'all know about criminal justice reform. That's racism, discrimination, and they've been dogging us. So you ain't got to keep going through the courts and the parole board. Let the man out. He's 84 years old. You got Bill Cosby, who was 84, who's blind. You got a blind black man in prison who's blind. You sent the prisoner to do time, not to die. And don't let them keep killing our people. As Rev said, we need to write all of the Black Panthers. We got men and women been in 20, 30, 40 years. You got a guy in California named Chip Fitzgerald. He been in 50 years. And these folk won't let him out. They're talking about, we got to go through the probe. We got to go through the procedure. What procedure? Racism, discrimination, and segregation got us all in there. Y'all ain't played fair from day one. And now when it's time for our people, they get released, let them come home and die with their families, man. I mean, how rotten and mean can you folk be? People 84 years old, been in 47 years, and you still won't let them out? Come on, y'all.
And there are a couple of other names I just want to lift up. I just have to. Mutulu Shakur, Russell Maroon Schultz, Veronica Bowers, you know. We have also the white allies of the Black movement, Chase Boudin's father and others, Rochelle McGee, the co-defendant of Angela Davis, still in prison from that. So, I mean, like you said, it's some joogie boogie going on. And I just want to mention one other thing. Reverend Lucado talked about Sumiata being an expert mathematician and working at NASA. Well, I know he once told me that he used to help Neil Armstrong, who later became an astronaut, the first astronaut to, you know, whitey on the moon, land on the moon, with his homework.
He was doing that while he was in the joint.
Sumiata Okoli, what'd you say, Roach?
He was helping out NASA while he was in the joint.
No. This is long, long before he went.
Before he did it. Okay.
Part of the growing, the upbringing, the type of person that Sundiata.
I mean, Sundiata graduated from Prairie View A&M in Texas, you know, back in 1956. And, you know, he worked in technology and computer oriented firms for 13 years, mostly in the New York area. So this is someone who was established, but was called. He then went and did voter registration work in the state of Mississippi. And so that deserved hazard pay in and of itself. You know, in 1968, he joined the Black Panther Party in Harlem. And so, you know, the comparison is important. I just want to point out something. I know a lot of people are talking about what happened in DC on last week. And they say that if it was If it would have been black people, if it would have been brown people, they would have been killed. And certainly and absolutely that's true. But I say, let's be careful about making this kind of comparison too, because what they did, what the Duck Dynasty domestic terrorists did back last Wednesday was an act of terrorism, which is not what we do.
Absolutely.
Which is not what black people have ever done. Back in 1967, the Black Panther Party was peacefully protesting what was called the Mulford Act in California. And they went down to Sacramento, to the state capitol, to peacefully protest how in the Mulford Act, what they were trying to do was to disarm all of the communities because the Black Panther Party had started to police the police. And they said, we're not going to stand by and watch you just kill black people. We're going to make sure that you follow the law. And we're going to do it while we're armed to make sure that you know that we're serious. And the state legislature decided they wanted to ban. This was the first time you had groups like the National Rifle Association to start supporting gun control. They started supporting gun control because they didn't want black people to be armed. And they went down to California to the state capitol to peacefully protest and to read a statement.
And they had legal arms. Their arms were legal.
And everything they were legally carrying. And they accidentally took a turn and ended up walking onto the floor of the state legislature in California. And they read their statement, but all of them got locked up. All of them were Bobby Seale, you know, the leadership that they had decided they weren't going to send Huey Newton to go to be a part of that because they didn't want to have all their leaders there. But the Black Panther Party was arrested. They were locked up. But we were not doing, wasn't nobody climbing no walls. Wasn't nobody busting up no windows. Wasn't nobody attacking black or white police officers and beating police officers. You know, all of the things that we try to say, well, if black people did this or if the Black Lives Matter movement does, that's not what we do. We come peacefully. We come in the name of our human right to self-defense. We come with integrity and with principle, with the best of who we are, and they still act that way. Mm-hmm. So recognize it's not a one-to-one comparison. They allowed for this to happen, and I argue in some ways it maybe even been an inside job. They allowed for this domestic act of terrorism to occur with the instigation and the encouragement of a sitting president. But the level of activity that they were involved in is no way compared to what we did in the Black Lives Matter movement.
That's right.
This summer, what we've been doing in terms of our marching and protesting. And so understand the extreme contradictions between the justice that we get and the justice that are reserved for other people. Yeah. And that's what we need to think about when we think about Sundiata Okoli.
We have anybody on the line, Mike? We have any calls?
He's talking about just us. Yes. It's just us. It's not everybody. It is just us. Can you is there a website or email or some kind of way that people can get information on the hashtag Bring Sundiata Home?
Sure. Well, The easiest way to connect with the Sundiata Okoli Freedom Campaign is simply go to sundiataokoli.org. And you can get information about Sundiata, about his background, about his history. There are a number of links to recent articles and his address is there, ways that you can legally send money to federal prison. So all of that information is there. I would say for those who are used to navigating social media, put in the hashtag, hashtag bring Sundiata home, and then you will be connected to a number of sites. We are setting up an Instagram page. We're doing a major launch of this coming up this Wednesday, and so there'll be more information that'll be available, but you can track some of what's going on through Bring Sundiata Home, and so that's going to be the way that you'll be able to make contributions as we move forward. We're calling upon, I'm a pastor in Princeton, New Jersey. And so we're calling on pastors and faith leaders and imams and rabbis and those who collect money every week to encourage them to take up a special offering. We know sometimes some of our communities have criminal justice Sundays, or we have certain focuses during Black History Month. And so we're encouraging people take up a justice offering that can be given so we can provide information, so we can get support for legal appeals and the other work that is necessary for us to bring Sundiata home this year.
So okay. I know you have a big march, your Martin Luther King action plan for this Saturday. Can you speak very briefly on that? And just encouraging folk, if you want to call in, dial 202-588-0893 to speak to Reverend Lukata Mjumbi of the Sundiata Akoli Freedom Campaign. Go on, my brother.
Yes, well, as we know, people are mobilizing all around the country for the celebration of the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., whose birthday is the day after Sundiata's birthday. Dr. King was born on January 15th. Sundiata was born on January the 14th. But on this weekend, this Saturday, in the city of Newark, which you talked about, Brother Brown, earlier, and I want to give a shout out and credit to our brother Mayor Ras Baraka. That didn't just happen by accident in terms of the police not firing a shot over the course of the year. It has to do with strong Black leadership that's pointed in a certain type of direction and that's accountable to and speaking to with a strong Black and organized community. But the People's Organization for Progress is organizing a mass mobilization, a march in honor of the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King. It's a march and rally for racial and economic justice. That's going to be on this Saturday, January 16th at 12 noon. We'll be meeting at the Lincoln Statue, which is on 12 Springfield Avenue. I know that we have listeners here in D.C., but there are people all over the country and all over the world that listen to this radio show. So if you're in New Jersey, if you're near Newark on Saturday at 12 noon, we're meeting at the Lincoln Statue on Springfield Avenue. And we're asking for you to come to march, to bring signage that says bring Sundiata home. Again, you can get more information at sundiataakoli.org. Sundiataakoli.org. That's SundiataAkoli.org. Sundiata Akoli. So you can join us because we are making sure that not only is Sundiata known, but we're bringing him home.
All right, Brother Roach, I think there's a caller on the line.
Yeah, we got a caller on. We'll take our first caller. Question or comment, right, please. You're on the air.
Yes, sir. It's a pleasure hearing you guys. You guys are something that's been around, or someone that's been around for a long time.
Uh-huh.
But these oppressors classified us as weak because of our upbringing is peaceful people. And I thought I heard that the uprising is the third time that it takes place. And I hope to God that all of you gentlemen out there with the wisdom, knowledge, and understanding, I know y'all ain't going to get your hand on no weapon because all the weapon is in the other people's hands. But God is your weapon. So, stand strong on the uprising. Don't let it go again. If you let it go, it's going to be like what Martin Luther King said, we are late.
Yeah.
Have a great day.
Thank you. Thank you for calling. I just want to say one thing before we go back. There's 16, at least 16 more Black Panthers still inside of the institutions. And man, I want to call a few of them's name off that would just blow your mind. Matula Shakur, been in 30 years. Russell Maroon Schout, been in 44 years. Kamunu Siddiqui, he's been in 45 years. Pete O'Neill, been in 46 years. Ed Pondexter, been in 46 years. Rochelle McGee, been in 53 years. People, the same way Black Lives Matter came about as a result of all the cop killers now, the Black Panthers came about back in the 60s and the 70s because of all the cop killers and the abuse and the discrimination. People, then we got to stop it. We got men and women who risked their lives for us, who didn't like what was going on all in this country. And they're still being punished 30, 40, 50 years after the offense. We got to do something to bring our people out. And all that jiggy boogie about the courts and the parole board, that's junk. We need to get our people out of there, man. They're dying. And by Sudiata Kohli in his 80s, the COVID virus, man, is killing our people faster than anything else. And somebody's 80-some years old. What the hell are you going to keep him in there for? He can't do nothing. He didn't. All the studies that prove you age out of crime. I came in the 20s, in the 60s for the murder beef in 1964, 55 years ago. I haven't committed another crime. So you commit one or two crimes back in your 20s and 30s. Your worst thing you do, you shouldn't let that be to judge you for the rest of your life from your worst mistake. People, our folk need to come home, and we need to stand up and ask for them, because last week we had a thing about Baltimore, right down the street road from New Jersey. The population in Baltimore was 30% black, but the prison population is 70%. Y'all know this ain't right. And they got to file to go to court, got to file an appeal or go to the parole board. That's jiggy boogie. Let our people out of that, man. Y'all just cut it out. Yes. Let them out.
Yes. And we have to do it. We have to do it. I remember when I was in my 20s, I remember I was on the phone with Sundiata, and I asked him, I said, so when do you think they're going to let me out? And he said, they're not going to let me out. You're going to get me out.
Yeah.
He said, the state doesn't determine how long a political prisoner, how long prisoners remain in prison. The people do. And if we don't decide that we are going to get him out of prison, if we don't decide that it's time for Sundiata to come home, that we will bring Sundiata home this year, he will not.
Keep
it up to them. He'll be there. He'll be there until he dies.
And like Nkechi and I always say, from Frederick Douglass's quote, "Power concedes nothing without a demand." It never did, uh-huh. And it never will. We got the power, y'all. We proved that in Georgia. We got the power.
Absolutely.
The power. Yeah. And you know, Sundiata, as Reverend Lucado put it, he is a multi-dimensional person. He is a poet. He is an artist. In fact, the very first portrait he made, so he said to me, was a portrait of you of me, and I got it right here. I visited him in Marion Federal Penitentiary way back in the day when he was in Marion.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's like compassion. Where is the compassion? We know they can show compassion because we saw it shown last week on January 6th, you know what I mean, to other people. Where's the compassion?
Like you said, Rev, these are our folk, man, and we got to do what we got to do to bring our people home. And you said the word political prisoners. These are political prisoners. When you took a stand against the police, against racism, against the cop killing, against the discrimination, how we getting all this time, then they lock you up and put you in the prison. And they use political reasons to keep them in. Our Black Panther's still inside. We got women been locked up 30, 40, 50 years, man.
That's right.
This is all about politics, because of your politics, because you said you don't like the way they're shooting us, killing us, and mistreating us. They give you a charge and you're locked in prison and you go in front of the United States Federal Parole Board. Yes, I said it. The United States Federal Parole Board is a racist, mean-spirited institution. Somebody did 20 years and go up and see the parole board and they tell you to do 15 to 20 more years. That breaks your back. They are designed to kill you and to break your back. And I was able to come out through the parole commission and I had a couple of suits I filed against them. So what? Let our people out, man. These people in their 70s and 80 years old, they're getting blind, they're infirm, they're handicapped and disabled. And they're what we call now, they age out of crime. When you're in your 70s and 80s, you don't commit crimes no more the way you did when you was in your 20s and 30s. You age out. Our people out.
We're leading with compassion. We're leading with the issue dealing with aging. We're leading with the issues dealing with COVID-19, and he's a COVID-19 survivor. So we're trying to lead with those issues, that there is no issues with anybody in the population. No one should have an issue with an 84-year-old person.
Okay, our time is running out. You want to give us a brief closing remarks, Rev? Some information on how people can get in touch.
Well, yes, I would just, again, encourage people on social media, use the hashtag bring Sundiata home, to go to the website of the Sundiata Kohli Freedom Campaign, where you can get the address And we're asking people to send Sundiata a letter for his birthday. His birthday is January the 14th this week. You can go to sundiataacoli.org. That's sundiataacoli.org. Go ahead and send that to us. And again, at this, if we don't bring our prisoners home, it says something to the next generation.
There you go.
It says something to the next generation. Why am I going to fight for you if I'm going to get locked up for fighting for you and you're not going to get me out? If I'm going to die in prison. It destroys our movements. It destroys our future. We must bring Sundiata home this year. Our responsibility.
You said the right word. They fought for us. Back in the day when Black folks were afraid to stand up, afraid to speak, the Black Panthers came about as that. Same way Black Lives Matter coming about as a result of all this stuff. People, we got to stand up for our own people. We're going to say thanks to Reverend Lukuta Mjumba.
Lukuta Mjumba.
Lukuta Mjumba. Man, I have trouble with these names, man. You
that's all right.
Me,
that's all right.
My heart is in the right place, brother, man.
Yes, sir.
I say thanks to my wife, Mertine, to my co-host, Nikichi Nataifa, Mike. I can't get nobody's name right this morning. Yeah. I didn't have my Kool-Aid. I got to go back and get me a glass of Kool-Aid. Thanks a lot, everybody. We'll be coming great back show. To you again. Please, people, let's bring our people home. They got 20, 30 Black Panthers who risk their lives. Bring our seniors home.
Yes,
we
yes.
Need it here.
Now.
Bring until the next time.
Great show, everybody.
Thank you for listening fantastic. To Crossroads. Until the next time, remember, your inner voice is never wrong. Merry Christmas.
Protest Saturday. Philadelphia. No. New Jersey. That was great. Great show. Fabulous
right.
Show.
Thank you, y'all.
Nice meeting you, Rev. Great show.
You recorded it also, right?
I recorded the second half. I'll send you the recording that I did.
And WPFW archives. I recorded it from the beginning.
Okay, great.
Yeah,
thank you.
You'll get it all.
Archives it. Now, Murchie, what were you saying about Mike? I never knew this. That Mike-
I know, Native American. We know he's a Native American Indian, but he said his granddad built that country store.
Do a show on him. I didn't know quite how to bring that
okay,
in.
Okay, we sure do need to bring that in. Yeah, that's powerful, all us with DC natives on this call.
Yeah.
Yeah,
that's right around
that?
Wheeler Road and Southern Avenue, right around the corner from where I grew up.
Wow!
I started out in Berry Farms. That's where I was born.
Wow, Berry Farms.
But then my family moved on the other side in Prince George's County in Temple Hills, Hillcrest Heights. So that's where my mother lives now.
Okay, sounds good. I'm gonna...
Thank you, Nkechi. Thank you, brother Brown. Thank you, Martine. Thank you. I appreciate you all. Good meeting you.
Okay, peace and blessings. I'm gonna end the call now.
Hey, Rev. Hey, how you
doing,
Rev?
Wait. Let's take a picture. Let me take a picture. Hold on.
Yeah, that's a good idea.
We never did that
before, man.
Okay, here we go.
Seen you before, Rev.
Yeah, let me get one too.
Can you hear me,
Nkechi?
Okay, I got
it. Say it again, brother.
Huh? Can you hear me?
Oh, yeah.
Yes.
I've seen you before, Rev. You look like my
Well, I'm out here. I'm out here.
You're what partner?
No, old cell partner.
Old cell partner.
You think it's possible we can get done?
Hey, I don't come from a long line of preachers. I come from a long line of sinners.
We're still recording. Should I turn off the recording?
That's all right.
That's all right. It's all good. Any last statements or words?
All right. Thank you.
Okay. I'm going to turn off. Let me stop recording.